Cross Currents is made possible by a grant from the Vermont Council on the Humanities and Public Issues.
This is Cross Currents, a series of programs exploring issues of public concern in Vermont. Today, novelist William Gaddis discusses American attitudes toward success and failure. His talk is entitled The Theme of Failure in Contemporary Literature. William Gaddis received the National Book Award for Fiction in 1976 for his novel J.R. He has also written The Recognitions, a novel published in 1955. In the course of his career, the 57-year-old Harvard graduate has been the recipient of grants from the National Institute of Arts and Letters and the National Endowment for the Arts. On the evening of November 5, 1979, Gaddis spoke at St. Michael's College in Winooski, Vermont. The Theme of Failure in Contemporary Literature by William Gaddis.
I've been asked to give readings before and generally avoid them because I don't really see much point to it, to reading out of one's published work. Maybe if it is a work in progress, something that hasn't been published before, there would be some news there. But generally, I think that a book is very much between the writer and the reader. It's a very intimate connection between what the writer is trying to communicate one at a time to one reader off the printed page. And though we're told Dickens, when Dickens appeared here and read from his work, when he read The Death of Little Nell, he wept, and the audience wept with him. Oscar Wilde, of course, said anyone who can read The Death of Little Nell, the scene of The Death of Little Nell, without breaking into laughter, must have his heart of stone. I think the heart of it, though, is I feel that once a book is written, and once a novel is written, it is very much on its own out in the world, and there is no way that the writer can run after it and say, this is what I meant. It's either got to do it or it doesn't. I wrote in this first book, in The Recognitions, which is a long novel about a forger, a man who forges paintings, among other things, his wife wants to go to something, meet a poet or a novelist or something, and he says, this passion for wanting to meet the latest poet, to shake hands with the latest novelist, get hold of the latest painter, what is it? What is it they want from the man they didn't get from his work? What do they expect? What is there left of him when he's done his work? What's any artist but the dregs of his work, the human shambles that follows it around? What's left of the man when the work's done but a shambles of apology? And I still pretty much feel that way. When this book won the National Book Award, I had to put together a little acceptance kind of a number, you know. And I was assured by after it that the New York Times said I was not eloquent. I think Publishers Weekly said that I did not have a platform presence. And my own son said, don't worry about it. For most people, the NBA means the National Basketball Association, so it's not going to make any difference at all. So on the strength of that, I thought, since I don't think anyone heard what I said that evening, I'll inflict it on you now. I said, I feel like part of a vanishing breed that thinks a writer should be read and not heard, let alone seen. I think this is because there seems so often today to be a tendency to put the person in place of his work, to turn the creative artist into a performing one, to find what a writer says about writing somehow more valid, more real than the writing itself. In this regard, I was struck by something I read recently in a preface to a novel of Gorky's. Before 1800, the editor noted, the main problem about being a writer was to keep writing well. By the end of the century, the main problem was to write well enough to establish or to maintain the position of being a writer. And I still think all that is valid. However, this whole idea of trying to maintain a kind of isolated position and a kind of an anonymity and a kind of staying out of it often isn't consonant with paying the rent and getting through. And it also brings other perils. When my work has sometimes been compared with that of Thomas Pynchon, and when Gravity's Rainbow came out about 2 years or three before J.R., one reviewer wrote in New York Post that since Pynchon is totally inaccessible, and I've been fairly so, that this might well be my second novel, because it had been heard that I was working on a long second novel, and that maybe Pynchon and I were the same person. There was also, someone told me down in the village, down in the bars that I used to frequent, someone carrying my first novel around and telling people what hard work it had been to write it. And I thought, we got to get out of this this business of trying to stay out of the scene. Is maybe it's not that good an idea. Then I got a letter saying, "Dear Mr. Gaddis, for the past several years, a man calling himself William Gaddis resided with my wife's aunt, Mrs. So-and-so, who died early this year. We are interested in getting in touch with Mr. Gaddis because my wife is the executrix of Mrs. So-and-so's estate, and several irregularities have been uncovered, including the unauthorized sale of some of her stock by Mr. Gaddis at a time when Mrs. So-and-so was in the hospital in a comatose state. Although Mr. Gaddis has claimed to author some books, we are not inclined to put much stock in it and believe that he is just an impostor who has assumed your identity." Then I thought, we gotta clear this up. So maybe I should get out in the world a little bit. I think one point that has always struck me about this is Thackeray wrote an essay, a short piece called "On Being Found Out," and I think this may be part of the sense one had or that I have of the whole idea that a writer, in a sense, is a confidence man. That very much, when Coleridge talks about this willing suspension of disbelief. This is what fiction is. I mean, you're asking the reader to suspend his disbelief and go along with this number you're putting on him. And that, of course, this is what the confidence man is doing too. And I think it's part of why many writers have been very taken with the figure of the confidence man. Because, you know, there's a kinship there. On the other hand, I think there is no pleasing the writer. I mean, he just won't have it either way. There is a story that I think the one I'm the most fond of in the way of jokes, which is, a man comes into a bar and orders a glass of beer, and the girl puts it in front of him, and he lifts it up and suddenly puts it down and says, "I can't drink this." And the barmaid says, "Well, why not? What's wrong?" And he says, "Well, there's a mouse floating in it." And she says, I'm awfully sorry," and takes the glass away and lifts the mouse out and throws it in the drain and puts the glass back down in front of him. He says, "Well, I can't drink this." And she says, "Well, man, there's no pleasing you. You won't have it with the mouse and you won't have it without the mouse." And I generally think this is the way we go on. Although I talked once about this to a writer I like named Stanley Elkin, and Elkin said, "Well, you know, you're all wrong. I mean, of course we can be pleased. All we want is people to tell us this is the greatest thing I've ever read." And Stanley has something there. On the question that comes up sometimes of whom one writes for, I think when one actually is sitting down writing, you're not writing for anyone but yourself. I don't think it is for the reviewers. I don't think reviews sell books, really. even good reviews, although of course you never know, even if you got a lot of good reviews, you think, well, they didn't help sell the book, but you don't know if you hadn't got any, maybe you mightn't have sold any books. So, I think eventually the only person that the reviews make much difference to is the writer. That I got with J.R., which might cheer you up. It was in the New Yorker magazine. He said, recently a group of avant-garde critics has put forward the idea that books should be made unreadable. And this is in addressing this problem of difficult or demanding or what have you. This movement has manifest advantages. Being unreadable, the text repels reviewers, critics, anthologists, academic literati, and other parasitical forms of life. Then he mentions the idea that everyone has the idea anybody can write a book. But what then of the truly unreadable book? This surely must be within every man's reach. Yet again, the answer is no. To produce an unreadable text, to sustain this foxy purpose for over 726 pages, demands rare powers. Mr. Gaddis has them. So, I mean, you have to live with that, too. Then this fellow went ahead and wrote a book, and there was a review of his book that I must say cheered me up. The reviewer said, of the critics of reputation now writing in English, he is the one who has yet to do an honest day's work of practical criticism. So that helped. Curiously, then, the question of the academic world, I think at first you write a novel and what you want is everyone to come out and buy it and read it and talk about it and say, wow, you know, this is a terrific novel. And then they don't. And then you see a few reviews which say this will be material for a lot of doctoral papers, and you think this isn't what I had in mind, you know, to be in effect entombed in someone's thesis. But then gradually you get quite grateful for this, and you realize the only way this thing is going to stay alive is probably going to be through academic preoccupation with it. The problem comes, I think, when you get into what a great deal of the academic approach has got to be all about, which is tracing down the particulars, for instance, derivation, you know, what does this mean, where did he get this, what influenced it, and so forth. In one recent review of J.R., the fellow who wrote the thing, said that it was filled with farcically symbolic names. For instance, Bast, B-A-S-T, who is one of the central figures in the book, Bast, phlegm, P-H-L-O-E-M, related to Greek phallos and short for bastard, child of opposing values. And I read this and thought, wow, what is this Greek derivation? I lifted the name Bodley out of a novel of E.M. Forster's that I like very much, because Bast conveyed my idea of this character as being a rather passive character. But now here it is in print, which some other academician will find, and say, ah, oh, yes, he derived it from the Greek and so forth. And you can't keep up with it, and you can't run along after it. I mean, I can try this evening, but there are other busy hands, you know, in other parts of the country, I'm sure, working on a thesis, which is picking this one up. On the other hand, or rather, with the first book, with the recognitions, there was a suggestion that this was like Joyce's Ulysses. And in the reviews, you'll see Joyce's book was mentioned frequently, and one fairly long critical piece appeared in one of the small reviews, which said, with James Joyce, the 20th century has produced its most consummate literary artist, and it is to William Gaddis' credit that he has sought and found in Joyce both a direction toward the future and a definite delineation of what has been accomplished, so that the recognitions at once acknowledges its debt and proclaims its individuality, which was all very flattering, but I had never read Ulysses. And In fact, still haven't, I have to confess to you. In that, I mean, it cited all kinds of parallels, of things that presumably I had lifted from Ulysses, that Wyatt's wife, Esther, is in my book, has obviously learned from Molly Bloom the technique of drying handkerchiefs on a mirror to avoid the necessity of ironing them. And that one I had picked up. I was in Panama, and I had heard this, and so I had ironed a lot of washed handkerchiefs when we still used handkerchiefs and had them drying on the mirror and panes of glass in the hotel room, and a friend came up, a Panamanian friend, and said, who's dead? And I said, what do you mean? Nobody's dead. And he said, well, you got all the mirrors and everything covered. And I had never heard this story about covering mirrors, covering glass, and so forth when someone dies. So I wrote it down and got it into this novel out of what I like to call real life. And even faulting real life, reading McTeague at some point, which is, what, 1900 or, you know, it's a long time ago, there is a little old lady washing handkerchiefs and spreading them on the mirror as a way of ironing them. So this whole problem of derivations, I think, is something that one should be quite careful of. On the other hand, it can work in one's favor. In one doctoral paper I read, it said Wyatt's designing in the early part of the book, this character Wyatt, who later goes into painting and forging paintings, works on bridge design. And his father is a Protestant minister in New England. Wyatt's designing of bridges relates him metaphorically to his father. It is Pontifex. Pontifex, bridge builder or high priest. Reverend Gwine in terms of divine ceremonies, Wyatt in terms of human art. That had never occurred to me. Like Wyatt, he is, and then another, talking about another character in the book, like Wyatt, he is set apart from others in the novel, and indeed his death by falling stones in the book's climax is in reality a death by proxy of Wyatt, rechristened Stephen after the first Christian martyr who died by stoning. And again, that had never occurred to me. So, you know, I feel maybe it's best thing just to keep your mouth shut and get credit for things like Pontifex and these very elaborate connections, which one had no idea of at the time. And in effect, you know, if you go along with it, what you lose on the swings you make up on the roundabouts, and that's the only way to just let it go. I think eventually, you know, when people ask you why you write and so forth, and then you will hear writers talking about what a, you know, it's a terribly lonely thing, and it's a, you know, what you suffer and like people describe the presidency, you know, it's a very lonely profession and you agonize all alone and so forth and so forth. That's all true. On the other hand, it is really, I think, a rather monstrous act of ego to sit down and write a long novel and in effect insist one's vision on a lot of total strangers, or try to, you know, who have never done anything to me, but I expect them to take this as a kind of gospel. There is, in the end, I mean, one chooses to do this, and so to say, to complain about the agonies of it, I don't think quite holds water, because it is, on the one hand, it's awfully self-indulgent way to spend one's time. And it also, in its way, is, I think, sort of the last bastion of free enterprise. I mean, there's no retirement plan, there's no pension plan, there's no dental plan. Insurance, since I'm self-employed, I get to pay both parts. I get to pay the employer's part and the employee's part of the Blue Cross. In fact, I think about the first fan letter I got which for the Recognitions read this way: I have just read a review of your book, The Recognitions, and I have just this to say. Anyone in this day and age who would write a 956-page book and expect people to read it must be a conceited idiot. Yours truly, Charles Norcross. And of course, I was, you know, that isn't what you want to get in the mail, but I did think, well, he's sort of got a point, you know. Into the question of why one does get into this kind of thing, years ago, a friend of mine who was an editor said he did not remember reading a book that he had felt worth reading, which had not been written out of indignation of some sort, or indeed of outrage. And I think there is something to that. It can be indignation with anything from the condition of society to God's ways to man to any of this whole vast spectrum of inequity that we live in. But I think often indignation is very at the heart of a lot of novels that are written, of good ones and bad ones. I think also, I mean, my feeling looking at my work has been a sense of a sense of great disorder in the world, and an attempt to restore order, or to rescue order, or to find order on a disorderly world, which one can't live with. In Nathaniel West's novel *Miss Lonely Hearts* in 1933, there was a passage I like very much. He sat in the window thinking, man has a tropism for order. Keys in one pocket, change in another. Mandolins are tuned G, D, A, E. The physical world has a tropism for disorder, entropy. Man against nature, the battle of the centuries. Keys yearn to mix with change. Mandolins strive to get out of tune. Every order has within it the germ of destruction. All order is doomed, yet the battle is worthwhile. This, in effect, 20 some years later, was Norbert Wiener's whole thesis on entropy in communication and nature's tendency always toward disorder. In the area of indignation and outrage, when this invitation came and I thought, what would I talk about? I thought, you know, what are these books about? And this seemed to be the persisting fact. The Recognitions is a book about a forger of paintings, which is a book by a young man who is distressed at the false values he sees prevailing around him, which, of course, was myself when I was a young man. But it's also the idea of it being a book about the refuge that the central figure takes as a forger is that he moves into a framework which precludes failure. In other words, if you are working in an area where the lines are of perfection are defined, and you have the talent that he's presumed to have, that you can accomplish something as approaching perfection as the original painter did, the painter whom he is forging. So there's no way you can fail. And just as in that book, being about forgery, I got obsessed with forgery, and then everywhere you look, all you see is forgery. I got this idea of failure, and everywhere one looks, one sees failure. Or our literature as about failure. And then I began to think, well, is all Western literature about failure? And you go down a list of American novels, and I just noted down Melville's Moby Dick and Billy Budd and Stephen Crane, Red Badge of Courage, Sinclair, Up in Sinclair the Jungle, Dreiser's Sister Carrie, Lewis's Babbitt, Steinbeck, Grapes of Wrath, Hemingway all the way down to the O Man of the Sea, O'Neill right down to A Long Day's Journey, Miller, Death of a Salesman, Sylvia Plath, The Bell Jar, Kaufman, The Diary of a Mad Housewife, Diddy and Played as It Lays, all of these, as I was cornering them in my head, seemed to me the central point is about failure. Also, of course, about the point being that it is about values and what may be a false value system. I think this is why many of us were quite irritated. I was certainly when that address that Solzhenitsyn gave at Harvard about what a mess America was and about the false values and so forth and so forth. And I thought, well, you know, American novelists have been trying to tell us that for 80 years. I mean, this is not news. And then what was to me was even more irritating was his solution, I mean, which all sounded like here's a man who would be very happy in the Spain of Philip II, and but it's got no room for any of us. I think in America, I wondered if we are, I think we have been self-critical, going back through our fiction all the way, and I think often there may be a tendency, a temptation to... one falls in the danger of seeing common failings or failings in, generally in Western society, as being peculiarly American. I mean, it was Lenin who said, "Who uses whom?" which I think is terribly at the heart of the whole idea of a manipulative society. So we are not singled out for this unfortunate approach, which is very at the heart of where we live, I think, in America and in the West. The point being, if one is going to discuss failure, then what one has got to say, well, all right, what is success? I mean, what are you failing at? I've thought one of the things about America right from the start has been the idea that you should win. You should be able to win. I mean, if this whole idea of equal opportunity for everybody was propagated, then you have no excuse for not winning. And if you do, it's your own fault, in effect. In Buddhist thought, I think our ideas of failure would make very little sense because our ideas of winning would make very little sense. And this would make very little sense. This is Vince Lombardi. I know some of you have heard this, but I think it is a ringing kind of picture of this approach to life. When he was coaching the Green Bay Packers, he said, "Winning is not a sometime thing. It is an all-time thing. You don't win once in a while. You don't do things right once in a while. You do them right all the time. There's no room for second place. There's only one place, and that's first place." And I don't know, maybe I'm not into football. Maybe that's fine for football. But I think when it spills over into life, we're in trouble. When the metaphor, it's curious how the president seemed to have always get into this, into the football kind of metaphor. Maybe it's because their tendency is toward this same idea of winning is what it's all about. In the water, right in the midst of the whole Watergate nightmare, Nixon was still calling out the coach of the Washington Redskins and giving him advice on what play to use that afternoon against the Dallas Cowboys or what have you. He was still thinking in these gridiron terms. And what just really stunned me was when in those last absolutely nightmare moments of when we pulled out of Vietnam, and there had been this attempt to put up another $69 million and keep the thing going, and then Congress would not do it, and then we left in that completely humiliating way that we did. And Gerald Ford, his comment was that he thought it was just a shame that in the last minute of the last quarter we hadn't been able to come through with that real final try. And I thought, my God, this guy is still thinking in the terms of the football field. I heard elsewhere that he had been voted most valuable player on his college football team, and the team had lost every game of the season. I thought, now there's something to think about. Anyway, to try to quickly get to this, what I picture is the kind of background of success and failure in the whole American dream, if you like. I think it has terribly to do with that the individual is much more important in America and always has been than, say, in Eastern societies, in Eastern cultures, and that a great deal of this came out of the rise of Protestantism and the rise of the Protestant ethic, in which one was, in effect, left alone with a God who was not telling you where you stand, that there was no intervention, there was nobody going to help you out, and you weren't going to learn till the last moment if you were in trouble or not, that the sort of conjunction of the rise of the Protestant ethic, of the idea of the perfectibility of man in the mid and late 19th century, of the proliferation of utopian novels which emerged from a world of ideas of social Darwinism on the one hand and scientific progress on the other hand, all these things together promised, in a sense, for the first time, a world which could be manipulated. I think the scientific progress was very much at the heart of the excitement, because it did look like all the wonders of science were going to solve everything. And the idea of manipulation became an acceptable one, an exciting one, and a positive challenge. What science asks always, of course, is measurement of tangible factors in order to predict the outcome of something and eventually control its outcome, right? So all that, with the Protestant ethic doctrine of useful work, and that one is put here to do useful work, the idea of pragmatism, which came along late in the century, and then William James got together succinctly right after the turn of the century, seemed to be the heart of the matter. In his essay, What Pragmatism Means, which appeared about 1906, he wrote, "If you follow the pragmatic method, you cannot look on any such word as closing your quest. You must bring out of each word its practical cash value, set it at work within the streams of your experience. Pragmatists don't lie back upon theories. We move forward and on occasion make nature over again by their aid. Pragmatism unstiffens all our theories, limbers them up, and sets each one at work. All these, you see, are anti-intellectualist tendencies. Against rationalism as a pretension and a method, pragmatism is fully armed and militant. It is the attitude of looking away from first things, principles, categories, supposed necessities, and of looking towards last things, fruits, consequences, facts. The pragmatist turns toward concreteness, adequacy, toward facts, toward action, and toward power." James, of course, this is not to disparage him, he was a brilliant man, And it seems, it's always seemed to me that pragmatism was a very American kind of a philosophy, emerging at a time when there was a lot of useful work to be done. At the same time, you can see this recipe is really an invitation to all sorts of bad news, and we've been getting it. Something I remembered I had written down 20 years ago, 25 years ago, something of in the book of Etienne Gilson. He wrote, "By reducing philosophy to pure science, man has not only abdicated his right to judge nature and to rule it, but he has also turned himself into a peculiar aspect of nature, subjected like all the rest to the necessary law which regulates its development. A world where accomplished facts are unto themselves their own justification is ripe for the most reckless social adventures. Its dictators can wantonly play havoc with human institutions and human lives, for dictatorships are facts, and they are also unto themselves their own justification." If you have read Dale Carnegie, How to Win Friends and Influence People, you will see the deplorable ends that a perfectly dignified philosophy like pragmatism can be brought to. In the way of exactly manipulation. If science is about manipulation, and if pragmatism is a scientific approach to life, which is to say the tangible, the concrete, the real, the facts, the reason that science wants facts is to manipulate them. And generally, if you manipulate them wrong, then the experiment doesn't work, presumably. I don't know anything about science, but I think that's the idea. You want something to work, and if you manipulate things wrong, it doesn't work, so you do something, you try something else. Whereas I think what we know about facts now, and when you get this manipulative approach to them in social concourse, first, money, as with Dale Carnegie, money becomes the index of what is worth doing, rather than, as the Protestant ethic had it at the beginning, you do useful work, and then money is sort of piling up over here as a testimonial to the useful work you've been doing, so you deserve it, and it's yours, and it makes sense. But it has always seemed to me the whole thing turned upside down, so that the money became the index, and the useful work became anything that would make money. This seems to me sort of at the heart of the kind of trash values that one reads about in these manipulative books. I remember when at the end of the Watergate thing, Haldeman, who was an advertising man, which is nothing but the whole point of it is manipulation. Haldeman's feeling was that Watergate had happened because of a failure in public relations. And he said this with a straight face and meant it. And when you think, I'm sure many of you have read the time that Plato spends in the Republic on trying to sort out the difference between the just man and the just man who may appear unjust as opposed to the unjust man who may appear just. But for someone like Haldeman, he's never stumbled across Plato, and all he's preoccupied with is the image, and this is what it was all about to him, and I suppose remains about. Again, I don't know if you've come across an English economist named Schumacher, who died not too long ago, but in a book of his called Small is Beautiful, the subtitle was Economics as Though People Mattered, which is I like. He quotes Lord Keynes, writing in 1930, in reference to that day which might not be that far off when everybody would be rich, and we can once more value ends above means and prefer the good to the useful. And then, quoting Keynes himself, says, "But beware, the time for all this is not yet. For at least another 100 years, we must pretend to ourselves and to everyone that fair is foul and foul is fair, for foul is useful and fair is not. Avarice and usury and precaution must be our gods for a little longer still, for only they can lead us out of the tunnel of economic necessity into the daylight." I don't know how many of you that phrase of the daylight at the end of the tunnel is familiar, but I mean, this was, of course, one of the lines out of, as Vietnam got worse and worse, we were being told that Westmoreland saw light at the end of the tunnel. And that seemed a curious kind of confluence there. Anyway, to me, that the whole nightmare of that, of Vietnam, fell into this process of logic and manipulation and facts so beautifully, which is to say, so depressingly well, because it was not as though the men who had brought it off were stupid and venal and rotten. They were, as Halberstam has said, the best and the brightest. These were men of high ideals and men of high intelligence and men of all sorts of high resources. And it was from them that we got this attempt to deal with the war in terms of body counts, in terms of budgets, all of which were lied about. I mean, manipulating facts, in other words, being simply lying, that the body counts were lies, that they lied to their own economic advisors, to the Congress, to the people about the money that was being spent on the war, about the real budget, because the end, they believed, justified the means. And in effect, foul was useful and fair was not. So it justified manipulating the facts, but you needed the facts first in order to manipulate them. Certainly McNamara is coming from being this man obsessed with cost efficiency and all the measures he brought to government and then to the war, had to end up in things like body counts and had to end up in budgets that was one figure here and a different figure elsewhere, and in effect had to end up where it all did. It was also, the whole idea of manipulating, you know, not just the budget and the body count and the war, but in effect this whole vast subcontinent, and all with good intentions, originally. Obviously, I think, then the whole youth revolt in the 60s was not that unreasonable a reaction, because what it was a rejection by these kids of the failure of the parent generation, the authority generation, and so forth, to deal honestly with them and with anyone, with everyone else. And on the one hand, it set up alternatives of communes and alternate things, like the kid who has got a doctorate becomes a carpenter or is out there making moccasins or something, and his father is thinking, wow, you know, this cost me $30,000 and he's making belts. On the one hand, a lot of it to Eastern, of the whole going toward Eastern thought, which is still a very real thing in this country, I think, which is to say, rejection of the success values and the manipulation that went with them. And then on the other hand, this whole occult of failure and the dropout and the drug scene and all this, all of which to me was all part of the same rebellion against a manipulative, success-oriented culture. The thing that is terrible is that none of it really has been resolved, that when you read figures like 2/3 of New York City's high school students fail a mathematics proficiency test, that's 2/3 of them. 45% of them, of high school students in New York, never finish high school. That's half of them drop out. And then most deplorable of all, across the nation, suicide as a second leading cause of death among between the ages 15 and 24. And this upsets me. I mean, that is, I think, it's just a very, especially, I mean, if you've got kids, as I do, it's a very, very distressing figure. Because to me, it comes out of a low opinion of oneself. And I think there is nothing more destructive and more terrible than a sense of defeat, which then becomes a sense of I'm not worth much. And then finally, either a kind of slow self-destruction, you know, drugs or what have you, or as Hausmann said, if it chance your eye offend you, pluck it out, lad, and be whole, but play the man, stand up, and end you when the sickness is your soul. And you think of a lot of kids feeling that way, and it is just one of the worst things I can imagine for any culture having to face. Again, Schumacher writing about this whole problem of societies, which is to say Western societies, not necessarily, but to us, of course, preeminently American, he says, if human vices such as greed and envy are systematically cultivated, the inevitable result is nothing less than a collapse of the intelligence. A man driven by greed or envy loses the power of seeing things as they really are, and his very successes become failures. The gross national product may rise rapidly, as measured by statisticians, but not as experienced by actual people, who find themselves oppressed by increasing frustration, alienation, insecurity, and so forth. Well, this, of course, I think is what all our novels are about. Increasing frustration, alienation, insecurity. This is all you get. And the reason they do touch a raw nerve, and the reason that people do buy them, and they do go to the movies, on the same lines, is because this does speak to something in their own experience. Going back to this whole idea of obsession with facts, and what is curious in terms of facts and manipulation is, of course, this is exactly what any novel is about. I mean, a novel is sort of the height of manipulation. It is creating an environment or attempting to recreate an environment, which is simply, you know, stacking the deck however the writer wants to show it to you. And forcing the characters to move around and manipulating them all the time. The curious thing, how facts have tyrannized always in American writing, when it broke away from European writing, and so-called American realism before 1900 even, this obsession with facts, this obsession with the tangible. Jack London, one of his lines, shouting the line, give me the fact man, the irrefragable fact. And you read Upton Sinclair's The Jungle, and you learn all about the meatpacking industry in Chicago, whether you want to or not. He has got all of the facts to make sure that the picture he is drawing, as horrible as it is real. This kind of realism that is related to facts. As back with Melville's Moby Dick, some little girl wrote about it tells me more about whales than I really want to know. And, of course, what you learn about whaling, you know, if you read that, maybe more than you want to know, but it's an awful lot about of sheer facts. There was the story of Dreiser, in writing An American Tragedy, when Clyde is going to be executed. And Dreiser went up to Ossining, up to Sing Sing, and up to Sing Sing prison, and got, through some kind of influence, got into the cells, into the death chamber, and got the measurements and got everything, got the facts all correct, so that when he got Clive into the going toward his execution, he would have all the facts right. in Sister Carrie. He's got, she comes to Chicago and she's working in a place where they make shoes, and the girl beside her is sewing one part of it, and then she passes it along, and this girl does something on her machine and passes it along. And you know that Dreiser didn't make this up. I mean, that he is giving us a little course there in shoe machinery, and that he went and actually got these facts. This may be part, I think it's still a very prevalent part of our approach to writing, is this obsession with facts. And it may also be part of something we see American writers very much doing, which is getting into a kind of journalism, even a very personal journalism, but still it is dealing with what really happened. So you get the so-called non-fiction novel and so forth. It is this inability to escape from the tyranny of facts, which I've certainly got, so I speak with conviction. In this last book that I wrote, J.R., this kid who gets into a big stock market conglomerate thing that he's building, I don't know very much about securities and the securities market, and I don't really care anything about it, but I thought it was going to work. I've got to get these things about how a defaulted bond issue really works and so forth, what could happen. I've got to have my facts right and in order to manipulate them for the purposes of the novel. Well, of course, the kid himself is this is what he does. I mean, he manipulates everything, you could say, where as though foul is useful and fair is not. I mean, it is that pragmatic approach of what works is what it's all about. At some point, he goes to, he's trying to talk to his teacher about a field trip to the Museum of Natural History, and he says something about where they have these stuffed Eskimos. And she says, "These what?" And he says, "You know, it's a picture of it in our book about Alaska. They have a picture of the stuffed Eskimos in the Museum of Natural History." And she's appalled, you know, and she says, how can you think this? And he just hasn't thought about it. I mean, he's seen the picture, and they do look like, you know, and he says, well, they got stuffed wolves there, and they've got stuffed lions and so forth. The idea of Eskimos as people has never occurred to him. In other words, everything outside of himself is a thing, is to be manipulated. I mean, other people are as much a part of the environment as a tree is. I mean, this is what I at least tried to get across. And he's not a bad boy. Let me tell you, he's a good kid. But he just doesn't. He is totally trapped in this idea that what you do is succeed, that everything around you is to be manipulated and to be manipulated before, for your own advantage. And if possible, before someone else does it. He has an idea of putting ads in textbooks. Why not? What's wrong with that? And of course, there's an outcry. And he says, you know, you have candy ads for candies in the first and second grade books, and then you get up into the seventh and eighth grade, and you have bicycle ads and so forth. And his idea always is that he's helping out. He says, in effect, you know, it'll bring the cost of textbooks down. And we put all these ads in. And then there is this outcry of contaminating textbooks with advertising. And as he says, and with some justification, I think, you know, everybody's always getting mad at me, but it's only because I do things first. You know, somebody's going to do it anyway. You know, why should they get mad at me if I do it first? Originally, I think, this idea of the theme of failure, though I've only touched on it, I think, sounds like a negative number. I mean, you see the sign, or that I'm going to come and talk on the theme of failure, and it sounds negative. But what it really is, of course, is failure in terms of what that calls attention simply to the idea of what is worth doing, and what is worth trying to do, which is to say, what is worth failing at in the last analysis. I think having written when I was out of college and tried to write for a couple of commercial publications and failed miserably and got very blue and low down about it, and a long time later realized, you know, it is... I never thought it was worth doing in the first place, except Collier's then paid $1,000 for a short story, so that was what made it worth doing, right? That was the same approach of money as the index of something worth doing. But I think nothing is more demoralizing than to fail at something that you knew wasn't worth doing in the first place. And I think this is a very basic problem that we have in America. As one character in JR says, there has never been a time when there were so many things, so many opportunities to do so many things that aren't worth doing at all. And I mean, this is my, that's my, part of my message. And the rest of it really is that the point is to fail, you know, if one is going to, and in the end, of course, you know, we're all going down the drain and it's not going to work and we're going to fail one way or another, I think. So the point is to try to at least fail intelligently and to fail at something that is worth doing and to come, so that one can come out of it placing value on oneself and thinking one is worth something in this world. And that's all I have. My only real advice is stop smoking and take care of your teeth. That's the only real tangible advice I can give any young person, especially anyone who wants to write, because both these are going to be problems. Thank you very much. Thank you very, very much.
We've been listening to William Gaddis speaking at St. Michael's College in Winooski, Vermont. Gaddis's novel, J.R., received the National Book Award for Fiction in 1976. His talk at St. Michael's, The Theme of Failure in Contemporary Literature, was presented as part of the English Department's Writers and Current Issues lecture series. This lecture by William Gaddis is available on cassette. If you would like a cassette copy of the program, send $1 in check or money order to the University of Vermont's IDC Media Library, Burlington, Vermont, 05401. That's $1 to the University of Vermont's IDC Media Library, Burlington, Vermont, 05401. This Cross Currents was produced by Fred Wasser, with production assistance by Elaine Weiss.
Cross Currents is made possible by a grant from the Vermont Council on the Humanities and Public Issues.